timeline time.
The first fuel-powered automobile was invented in 1885 by Carl Benz of Mercedes-Benz, who applied for a patent for his three-wheeled gasoline-powered Motorwagen the following year. But there were cars even before that, like this electric car that was invented in the 1830s, and this steam-powered tricycle, which had been rolling around France way back in 1769. Incredibly, it wasn't until 1955 that the world's first solar-powered vehicle was demonstrated. Even then, at a mere 38 centimeters long, it was too tiny for a human to drive. But then in 1962, a drivable solar-powered car was finally unveiled. Turns out, building a vehicle that's powered by the sun is actually a lot more challenging than using steam, or electricity, or really old carbon, also known as fossil fuel. But while commercially available solar cars haven't yet made it onto our roadways, what seems like an impossible piece of technology is actually very much a reality. And these solar cars are capable of going faster and further than you might think. What's more, the technology in today's solar vehicles could drive us all toward a cleaner, greener future. So in this episode, we take a look under the hood of one of the world's fastest solar cars to better understand, how does a solar car actually work? Like me, you've probably thought of solar cars as something out of science fiction, like a technology so futuristic and complex that it feels like it can't actually exist in the real world. But going back to William Cobb's 38 centimeter model car from 1955, the Sunmobile, it seems like solar cars of the past were pretty simple machines. This is today's solar car. Okay, it's a model solar car, but it is fully functional. It's about 8 centimeters long, just over 3 inches. So it's even smaller than that Sunmobile, but it's got all the same major components. Here's the solar panel that converts those photons into electricity. We actually covered that whole process in detail in a previous chapter, so check that out. That electricity then travels here to this small direct current motor, and that motor then converts electricity into mechanical energy, which propels the car. Check it out.
Now, as long as the car's solar cells are exposed to sunlight, there is enough power to keep the wheels turning and the car moving. But if that sunlight is cut off, well, then the car becomes a paperweight. Now, this basic demonstration, and yes, it is a very basic demonstration, it shows how solar cars of the past worked. If there were sunlight, they could go. No sunlight, no go. So you can see why solar cars of the past have not been considered a viable option.
Luckily, today's solar cars are a bit more sophisticated. Okay, a lot more sophisticated. The solar racers competing in the World Solar Challenge, for example, don't just use the latest in photovoltaic technology. They've also adopted innovations in design, engineering, and battery technology. To get a closer look under the hood of one of these solar racers, I got to connect with a few members of their racing team from Stanford University.
My name is Corey Brundle. I was the team lead for the 2019 Stanford Solar Car Project cycle.
My name is Cameron Hainsworth, and I'm a junior at Stanford University.
Hi, I'm Julia Gordon. I started out on the aerodynamics team, and throughout the race preparation time, I ended up in a kind of jack-of-all-trades role.
Julia was actually behind the wheel for the 2019 race, which unfortunately didn't go so well for the Stanford team.
I think like right as we got outside the city, I remember I started smelling smoke.
I smell not good smell.
I remember watching as they pulled the panel off, just flames come out of the car.
Although the Stanford team had a disappointing performance in 2019, the team felt that it was overall an overwhelmingly positive experience.
So we always go in with wanting to win, but I think one of the big principles underlying the team is just pushing the envelope for what we can do with engineering and technology.
So being able to work on a team that has so many different expertises working toward one common goal is great because you just get exposed to so many really new and kind of novel engineering concepts.
This drive to innovate pushed the Stanford team to make a pivotal change in their race car's design.
The project has been around for 30 years now. This was our 14th vehicle that we've built. We've always done like a multi-fairing car. Usually that's a catamaran, which is your traditional like two-fairing vehicle.
Yeah, Black Mamba was definitely a new car. We went to Black Mamba, which is a bullet car design, which means all of the wheels are in one fairing.
I'm not an aerodynamics expert, but single fairing is better for aero because you are eliminating extra edges on your car.
The trade-off to that is as you move your wheels closer together, it's a lot easier to tip your car. And the other problem is with the array size.
To get a really like small car, we went with gallium arsenide cells, because when you use more efficient cells, you can like reduce the size of your car.
We put the driver on the right side of the car, so it was asymmetric, which had some advantages with the aerodynamics as well as the shading of the sun on our solar panels so that the driver didn't shade the solar panels. And it was also the first asymmetrical bullet car in WSC. All of the other bullet cars in WSC were centered driver.
It felt like this one radical change just kind of spurred off more ambition and more drive to see how far we can just like really push Black Mamba.
Another major upgrade to the Stanford Solar Racer, gallium arsenide solar panels.
Well, in the past that we had done a silicon array, gallium arsenide is like a new development in solar panel technology that allows for higher efficiencies in solar panels.
We talked about gallium arsenide technology in our previous chapter on solar panels, so go learn all about that here.
The size of the gallium arsenide array was 3.56 square meters, and to cover that size of array, you need about 100 grand.
Now, to keep things competitive, the World Solar Challenge did limit the size of gallium arsenide arrays for each team, so that teams without the resources, meaning money, to access this technology could still compete in the race fairly.
So then gallium arsenide was a whole new technology with different current voltage specifications. So then that changes the entire electrical system because when you're operating at different current, you have to change things down there too. On the battery side, it's a whole new form factor that you have to fit in the car. For balance reasons, you would want the battery across from your driver so that your driver and your battery can balance each other out. So the battery had a whole new form factor.
The battery is one of the key upgrades to today's solar cars. Whereas solar cars of the past sent electricity generated by their solar panels directly to the motor, modern solar cars, like Stanford's Black Mamba, use photovoltaic technology to charge the lithium ion batteries that then power the vehicle.
So the basic gist is that you've got your solar array, battery, and motors. And then those are all connected by the internal circuitry of the car. So as the solar array generates power, that goes into your battery pack, which starts recharging. And the solar array also connects out to the motors.
This allows these solar cars to run even when there's no direct sunlight available.
There's gonna be times when you have more supply than you have demand, or vice versa. So really what you need is you need to have some kind of storage device so you can store all that power.
Now, after all of these upgrades and really a total reimagining of their solar racer, the Stanford team's Black Mamba came into the 2019 World Solar Challenge at a sleek 180 kilograms. Its single fairing asymmetric bullet design with a 3.56 square meter single junction thin film gallium arsenide solar array and 45 amp hour lithium ion battery pushed Mamba to a top speed of around 110 kilometers. Per hour. That is highway speed. Unfortunately, Black Mamba didn't hit top speed in Australia because, as the Stanford team learned the hard way in 2019, having a good battery to motor connection is absolutely critical.
We managed to get the battery out of the car before anything else really caught on fire.
When lithium ion batteries go, they go pretty violently.
Lithium ion technology is definitely a dangerous technology. If you do have a short, you can get a battery fire because things will just propagate really, really quickly.
Which brings us to the next two chapters of our Lightspeed Learning playlist, where we're gonna take a deep dive into the wonderful world of batteries. First up, how do lithium ion batteries work? Click the link to find out, or just let this playlist play.